Over the course of 10 centuries, Muslim pirates cruised the African and Mediterranean coastline, pillaging villages and seizing slaves. They would attack at pre-dawn on unexpected coastal towns. The Muslim raiders would kill as many of the non-Muslim older men and women as possible, collecting only young women and children to sell them into the slave markets of the Middle East as concubines or eunuchs. Many did not survive. Terrorizing Muslim pirates dispatched and commissioned from the surrounding Mediterranean countries, along with women and children passengers, and put them into this slavery. Many were never heard from again. The names of those who were captured by the Barbary pirates were read aloud each Sunday in their churches, just as those who were lost at sea. Some captives were held for ransom, but most of the money would have to be raised privately by widows and family friends and children, as Congress was unable to pay the full asking price.
It started actually in 1784, when they began to attack our merchant ships. That was the lifeline of our fledgling country. Import-export was something that we really needed. And they started to attack our ships and to capture our people and our goods and actually enslave our people. It has been estimated by several sources that at the end of the conflict, over 30 years later, that they had kidnapped 1.25 million people and enslaved them, some of them trying to actually sell them back to us for a ransom. But it's just an amazing thing in our history that we have forgotten that we fought a group of nations, Algiers, Tunis, Morocco, and Tripoli, around the Mediterranean, that were capturing our ships. We had no navy because, of course, our navy had been the Navy of Great Britain, and so we were separated from them, and these merchant ships were defenseless because the only type of cannon that they really had to speak of was normally used just to send a warning signal in the fog stating that they were there. And up to that time, international law had stipulated among nations that there was something called international waters. And within so many miles of any coastal area, that ship had safe passage. Well, Muslim terrorists back in those days, these extremists that were called the Corsairs or pirates, began to attack in force in 1784. Actually, before that, they were beginning to attack our merchant ships, even while we were beginning to draw to an end the War for Independence. We gave three men the charge to go over and try to talk with some of these Muslim nations. They were very interesting men. One of the ambassadors to the Muslim nations surrounding the Mediterranean Sea was Thomas Jefferson. Another one was Benjamin Franklin. The third was John Adams, even before George Washington became the first president under the new Constitution. And so they went over and they basically found out that these people did not want to be reasoned with, that all they only understood force, and that they had no intentions of giving up people that they had captured and enslaved at that time. Well, George Washington became the President of the United States, and the war began in earnest. And it wasn't until Thomas Jefferson became our third president that he realized we were paying over 20% of our gross national product as tribute money or extortion money to these Muslim nations. And he said, look, not one more penny for tribute, but millions for defense. And he took that same money that we were paying to these nations that were attacking us through their Barbary pirates, and he put it, invested it into our Navy and Marine Corps, and sent them over and started taking care of business. Just an amazing thing that we don't even know, many of us don't even know that there was such a thing as the Tripoli War or the Barbary War. And you know, I mean, the Marines remember it because they sang in their Marine hymn, from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli. And the Tripoli War is also another name for the Barbary Powers War.
The Barbary coast starts on the sort of top left of Africa, so the Atlantic coast of Morocco. It stretches through into the Straits of Gibraltar and then along that North African coast through all the kind of places which are in the news at the moment, Algiers, Tunis, and the city kingdom of Tripoli, which is modern-day Libya. That 2,000-mile stretch of North African coastline, that's the Barbary coast. In the 17th century, that area is under the nominal control of the Ottoman Empire. That means it's part of the Dar al-Islam. It's part of the lands of Islam. And it was always thought by Christians and Muslims that this area was on the front line. This is where the sort of little wars were fought out between Christendom and Islam. And it's no coincidence, I don't think, that a lot of the guys I've been writing about in the 16th, 17th century, they referred to themselves as Mujahideen. They were warriors for God. They talked about being on jihad. They were on sea jihad to push back the encroaching infidel. They were pushing back Christendom.
They're operating out of ports along this whole Barbary coast and preying on what kind of shipping in the Mediterranean?
They're preying on any kind of Christian shipping they can find. So it's mainly merchant shipping, and most of it is engaged in the Levant trade. That is a hugely lucrative trade between Smyrna, between, in fact, Constantinople, Istanbul. Ironically, you know, we're engaged in trade. The West is in trade with the Ottoman Empire. And a lot of English, French, Dutch, Spanish ships are moving along the Mediterranean to trade with the Greek islands, to trade with Aleppo in Syria, to trade, as I say, with Smyrna and Constantinople. And they're ripe for the picking. They're not treasure ships. They're not like the great Spanish treasure fleets. But then again, the pirates that I've been writing about aren't just after treasure. Sure, they want treasure when they can find it, but they'll take anything. They'll take the ship. They'll take the cargo, even if it's olive oil or currants or whatever, they can sell it. And very importantly, they'll take the crew. Piracy, and in fact the states of Algiers and Tunis and Tripoli, depended on slavery. The economies of these states depended on capturing slaves and ransoming them or selling them on. Something like 1 million Europeans were sold into slavery on the Barbary coast in the 17th century.
That's an appalling number. I mean, men, women, children, and yep. Sold as what? As domestic servants, as galley slaves? And
all of those things, Lewis. And also, importantly, if they were well connected, they're held for ransom. So they can, yes, they can be sort of taken on as cheap labour, but also they're encouraged to write home to sort of to London or Bristol in England and to say, look, help, mum and dad, brothers, sisters, you know, send money. I'm trapped here and my owner has set a price on my head. And the only way I'm going to get free is if you send money.
Olofs kigger længselsfuldt ud over havet. Han drømmer om at sejle ud, besøge fjerne lande, blive kaptajn ligesom sin far. Han er 12 år, og snart skal han begynde som skibsdreng på sin fars og onkels båd. Året 1720. Hak Olofs drømme udspiller sig på den lille, dengang danske ø Amrum, langt ude i Vadehavet. Han aner ikke, at hans udlængsel og drømme om de fjerne lande snart skal gå i opfyldelse.
Hak Olofs familie var en søfartsfamilie. Hans far var kaptajn og redder, og det kan man se, altså hele hans omgivelse levede af søfarten.
Hak Olofs døde ung. Han blev 46 år. Hans gravsten på kirkegården i den lille by Nebel på øen er helt speciel. Den fortæller brudstykker af den meget mærkelige skæbne Hark får.
Das ist die Hoffnung und auf dieser Hoffnung ist Hark Olofs dann gesegelt mit 12 Jahren und dann eben auch mit 16 Jahren aufgebracht worden, gekapert worden, dieses Schiff im Ärmelkanal und ist dann verschleppt worden nach Algier, Afrika, die Osmanen hatten ja das Mittelmeer besetzt.
I 1724 er den nu 15-årige skibsdreng Hark Olofs på sin fars skib Håbet på vej fra Nantes i Frankrig hjemad mod Hamburg, da det bliver opbragt af kabere tæt på Sillyøerne ud for den engelske kanal. Besætningen bliver taget og ført som fanger til Algier. Drengen Hark Olofs og de andre ombord kommer til at dele skæbne med ca. 1 million europæere, der fra 1500-tallet og til 1830'erne ender som hvide slaver i Nordafrika. Hark Olofs liv som slave i Nordafrika er exceptionel, først og fremmest fordi han overlever, men i særdeleshed fordi den lille skibsdreng fra Vadehavsøen ikke bliver en helt almindelig slave.
Jeg blev solgt på torvet i Algier by for 1000 cartouches. Det svarer til 500 daler. Dagen efter blev jeg solgt videre til en anden med 100 cartouches profit. Hos den nye ejer var jeg i 14 dage. Jeg arbejdede i haven, hvor jeg samlede morbærbede til min ejers silkeorme. Og så bar jeg vand ind og holdt hans hus ryddeligt.
Det er en storby, byen Algier, som den unge dreng Hark Olofs og de andre tilfangetagende øboere fra Amrum bliver ført til i 1724.
Altså hele byen lever stort set af kaperiet. Altså ikke kun med at tage andre skibe, men også at lave raids langs kysterne. Altså man overfælder landsbyer i Italien eller Spanien, og det bringer rigtig penge.
Men så kom der en slaveopkøber fra bagen i Konstantin til Algierby. Da han en dag så mig, fik han lyst til mig. Og min ejer overlod mig ham så for 900 daler. Jeg kom nu til byen Konstantin, hvor min nye ejer, Ben Asin, kan sammenlignes med en lille konge. Da jeg kom i hans tjeneste, var han allerede en ældre herre. Han var temperamentsfuld, havde et sundt udseende, var hjertelig og havde stor krigserfaring. Ben havde to fruer, som blev opvartet af 40 tjenere, mænd og kvinder. Iblandt dem var der fire kastrater, der arbejdede som fruernes kammertjenere. Bane selv blev opvartet af 30-40 lakajer, hvoraf halvdelen var renegater. Jeg blev en af hans lakajer.
Den største trussel kom fra Marokko, Algeriet, Tunis og Tripoli, det nuværende Libyen. Det var de såkaldte barbariskstater, hvor muslimske pirater eller kabere med støtte fra deres stater opbragte europæiske handelsskibe. At der næsten var en million europæere fordelt over 300 år, der blev slaver i Nordafrika, er en overset og glemt historie. Mange døde i fangenskabet som galejslaver eller byslaver. Kun få vendte hjem igen, som Hark Olofs, og det er fra dem, vi har beretninger om fangenskabet og om den islamiske kultur.